Dr. Himanshu Rai. Dr. Himanshu Rai, a multifaceted personality, is the director of IIM Indore. He's an alumnus of IIM Ahmedabad with PhD. His core area is human resource management, wherein he focuses on negotiation, mediation, arbitration, strategic HRM, and leadership. He frequently conducts training programs and workshops for executives as well as bureaucrats around the world. Dr. Rai provides strategic consultancy to the Government of India and in particular has audited programs sponsored by the Planning Commission of India. He also provides strategic consultancy to the state governments. His research with 30 papers and many books includes negotiations, ethical leadership, diversity, spirituality, etc. Dr. Rai, also a trainer for trainers, explores Vedic literature, practices yoga, a mountaineer, an avid quizzer, and a music lover. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Dr. Himanshu Rai.
A very good morning to you all once again, ladies and gentlemen. Subi said that it was her misfortune that she hadn't visited Indore before. At IIM Indore, we have made sure that we have corrected that and we'll have her indefinitely through the collaborations that we have planned. Now, why am I going to talk about how to take this $5 trillion economy from vision to reality? First of all, because when we spoke about the $5 trillion economy, many people said, why are we even talking about a vision? Why don't we work hard and we get somewhere? Now, that always reminds me of this book that I had read, and there's a particular story behind it, but I'll just talk to you about a little passage from the book. This book is called Alice in Wonderland. Now, most people think that it's a children's book, but it has affected me immensely. Now, for those of you who haven't read Alice in Wonderland, it's a story about this 12-year-old girl, Alice, who falls into a rabbit hole. And when she comes out on the other side of the rabbit hole, she reaches an anthropomorphic world, a world where animals talk just like human beings. And she's walking when she reaches crossroads, roads going in multiple directions. And Alice is confused. Fortunately for her, she sees a cat coming from the other direction. His name is Cheshire Cat. So Alice asks the cat, Cheshire Cat, where do I go from here? Which road do I take? The cat says, that depends a good deal on where you wish to reach. Alice says, I don't much care where. The cat says, then it doesn't matter which road you take. But that's not the end of the passage. Alice realizes that maybe that was not the best answer to give. So as an afterthought, she adds, so long as I reach somewhere. The cat says, oh, you will reach somewhere if you walk long enough. Now, there are two messages in this story. One obvious, the other a subtle one. Obvious message is, if you do not know what you wish to do with your life, then do anything. How does it matter? Yadi gantavya ki jankari nahi hai, to Indore ke railway station jao, kisi bhi train pe baith jao. But the more important lesson is, if you work hard in your life, you will reach somewhere. But is that where you wanted to reach? And the day the answer to that question comes as a no, everything that you would have achieved till that point of time in your life will become meaningless. And therefore, when we talk about a $5 trillion economy, we also need to talk about what does this $5 trillion mean? Is it simply about 5 and 12 zeros? Or is it something more? And this is where we have to talk about something called inclusive growth. As I said, 833 million people live in rural areas. When we look at women, the literacy rate of women, Subi spoke about Anu Aga being one of the role models. But how many role models do we have? Anu herself spoke about the fact that she was discouraged to pick up a leadership role. And that's what happens to women. We have women who are making a difference. RMI here has made such a phenomenal difference to the airport, to the Indore airport, completely changed it. Subi here is making a big difference. Anu here has made a difference. Remember, and this is something that I'm addressing to all the women over here. Every time you want to do something new, you want to pick up a leadership role, there'll be at least 10 people who will tell you not to do it and why you should not be the one doing it. 7 of them will be related to you by blood and 3 by marriage. My suggestion to you is listen to them. Listen to them very, very carefully and then do exactly what you want to do. Never live somebody else's dreams. Live your own dreams. It's best to be a good version for yourself rather than being a best version of somebody else's expectations. And therefore, this 5 trillion economy has to have an inclusive growth. Happy people, what would you do with the money if you're not happy? And therefore, please remember, happiness comes from a sense of fulfillment. Happiness comes when everybody around you is happy as well. I was shocked when in UP they took out a position of a peon. Close to 80,000 people applied, 80,000 students applied. And of those 80,000, 80% had a master's degree and about 5% had a PhD degree. What kind of a 5 trillion economy would we have if we have such joblessness? So please remember, it's okay that we have some of the schools. I represent one of the better schools in this country where the degrees mean something. But if you look at the schools otherwise, if you look at the colleges otherwise, to yahan pe berozgar logon ke bagal mein dabi hui degreeyan raddi ke us tukde ki bhanti hain jo aajeevika dilane mein asamarth hain hi raddi ka mol bhi nahi de payengi. And that needs to change. $5 trillion economy has to have happy people. And then there has to be peace and prosperity. I mean, look at what's happening around us. And finally, we need a happy planet. The one thing that kind of actually made me shed a lot of tears, in the Australian bushfire, so far, we have already lost 1 billion animals. Please wrap your head around it. 1 billion, 90s. We have lost these many animals. There are some species who have become completely extinct. And therefore, please remember, a $5 trillion economy cannot come at the cost of a planet. And thus, we need to understand, how do we reach there? What is the roadmap which will take us there? 8 to 9% GDP growth every year, domestic saving rates 39 to 40%, investment rate should be about 41%, and incremental capital ratio should increase considerably. And this is where I spoke about this virtuous cycle of investment, exports, and savings, which actually feed into each other and create that positivity that could lead to this. And the way forward to me, therefore, has these 7 elements of which I'm going to focus on only one. First is investment in infrastructure and intellectual capital. The second is boosting exports. The third is enhancing the ease of doing business. Fourth is empowering SMEs, and we already know we are sitting in the city of SMEs. 5 is strategies for inclusive growth. 6 is striking a balance for sustainability so we do not have another mass extinction as we are seeing it today. And finally, we need a completely different paradigm of leadership. And that is the job which was given to me here today to talk about what this enlightened leadership should look like should we want to achieve that $5 trillion economy. Now, this is where I bring my scriptures into place. What the current leadership is doing is trying to be Indra. Indra wants to accumulate wealth for just materialistic self-gain and hence always fails to attract prosperity. What we need is not merely achievement. Please remember, achievement without fulfillment means nothing. You can be the richest person on this planet, but if you're not happy from inside, you will never feel that sense of fulfillment. And therefore, what you have to do is, you have to change the leadership style from Indra to Vishnu, who wants prosperity for all and manages resources well, thus attracting wealth, thereby becoming the Lakshmipati. And therefore, in the management sciences, leadership has to undergo a massive change. And I propose to you this model that I call the be-no-do framework. As a leader, you have to be a kinesthetic communicator today if you want to achieve the $5 trillion. Now, who's a kinesthetic communicator? Many people, when it comes to communication, think of themselves as Abhimanyus. Ki maa ke pet se seekh ke aaye hain. But in the next 2 minutes, I'll tell you, Abhimanyu ki tarah hi aadha seekh ke aaye hain, baaki aadha abhi main sikhaunga. Communication has often been defined as an exchange of messages between a sender and a receiver. They say there is a sender who encodes a message, sends it to the receiver, who then decodes the message. However, what we do not understand is that it is not necessary that the way the receiver receives the message is the same as which the sender intended. And therefore, we need to understand what goes into this messaging. And you'll be surprised that the answer comes from the Rig Veda. Rig Veda has actually defined communication. The word in Sanskrit for communication is sampreshana. And Rig Veda says, samaniva akuti samana hridayaniva samanamastu vomana yatha vasu sahasati. It says there are three entities which participate in communication. Hirde, man, buddhi. Heart, mind, intellect. What originates in the heart? Emotions. Of course, you can point a finger at me and say, hey, emotions originate in the limbic system, which is next to the hypothalamus. Correct. But metaphorically, what we say is that emotions originate in the heart. So heart is the seat of emotion. Mind is the seat of desire. And intellect is the seat of judgment. Now, whatever happens in the intellect, in the process of communication, gets manifested through words. Whatever happens in the mind, process of communication, gets manifested through body language. And whatever happens in the heart, in the process of communication, gets manifested through facial expression and tone and tenor of the voice. And therefore, what the Rig Veda says is, when the heart, mind, and intellect of the receiver become the same as that of the sender, then communication has happened. Samaniva akuti, samana hridayaniva, samanamastu vomana. Why is this important? Because if I sit here and say, ho jayegi $5 trillion economy. Now my action is not matching my words. Or if I come and say, hey, I never get angry. Now once again, I may be saying I never get angry, but clearly my expression is that of anger. Leadership has to change. Leaders have to mean what they say, and it should be visible through their body language. Please remember, as a high context culture, we don't listen to the words very carefully. How many of you are listening to me, really? How many of you are listening to me? Okay. Pratyaksham kim pramanam? Abhi dekhi lete hain. Do exactly what I ask you to do, all right? Put your hand on your forehead. Put your hand on your eyes. Put your hand on your nose. Put your hand on your lips. Put your hand on your cheeks. Are these cheeks? That's your freaking chin. You were not listening to me. You were watching me. Kya kar raha hai ye vyakti? Leadership has to change. They have to give the expression. They have to actually show with their body that they really mean whatever they are saying. And that is the first paradigm change. You have to be emotionally intelligent. And leaders have to be open to new experiences and ideas. Now, what do I mean by this? You have to display emotions which are expected out of you. All of you consider Subhash Chandra Bose as a leader. I'm sure of that. Do you? Now, imagine if Netaji were to come to you and say, bhai, tum mujhe khun do, main tumhe azadi dunga. You'll say, bhago yahan se. Khun maangne aaya ki roti maangne aaya hai? But the same boss comes to you and says, tum mujhe khun do, main tumhe azadi dunga. Immediately, you will take it out. Yeah. Why? Because this time he has showed you the expression which was expected from a person who's asking you for your blood. And therefore, please remember, this paradigm also has to change. If you really want a $5 trillion economy, you have to inspire people. You have to say the words and you have to show the expressions and the emotions that are actually expected out of such a leader. So this is the B part. The second is the no part. And here the most important part is, know yourself. Now, you will say, hey, come on, I know myself. For example, if you were to come to me and say, hey, who are you? I'll say, I'm Himanshu, the director of IIM Indore. Please note, that is my most superficial identity. Because I'm getting it and I'm deriving it from a position that I hold. And remember, if you attach your sense of self-worth with your designation, the day your designation goes, so will your sense of self-worth. I'm not going to be a director forever. It's a 5-year tenure. And therefore, if you ask me, who are you? I'll say, I'm a teacher. Or I'll say, I'm a mountaineer. Because that is where I derive my real passion from. But there's a deeper level of identity that I want you people to think about, and that is Aham Brahmasmi. And please note, Aham Brahmasmi does not mean that I am Bhagwan. Khaskar sacred games ke baad sabko lagne laga ki kabhi kabhi ab unko lagta hai apunish Bhagwan hai. No. What it means is that I am a part of the larger consciousness. I am a part of the super consciousness. And when you are a part of the super consciousness, you owe something to the society. You owe something to the largest universe that you are a part of. And therefore, you and I cannot absolve our responsibility. And that's why I keep telling you people, if you want a $5 trillion economy, if you want to change this universe, if you want to change this country, start it with yourself. Don't wait for the government, don't wait for that gana gaadi wala aaya kachra nikal, do it yourself. Make sure that when you leave this auditorium, you leave it cleaner than you found it. Make sure that when you leave the person that you have been sitting next to, you leave him or her happier than you found that person. And that is the meaning of being a part of the super consciousness. Know your job. Unless you know your job well, nobody is going to respect you. And finally, know your people. This is something I learned from my first boss. My first boss, when I was working with Tata Steel after my engineering, was a person called Rusi Modi. And it was said of Rusi Modi that he knew the name of each and every employee of Tata Steel. And do you know how many employees we were at that point of time? 76,000. Even agar wo atishokti thi and he knew only half the people, 38,000 names. And when I asked him, Rusi, why do you do it? Rusi said, Himanshu, when I call somebody by their name, they actually feel connected to me. And which is why every time somebody calls me, sir, I say, I still don't have the knighthood. Please call me Himanshu. And the day I get the knighthood, I will let you people know and you can start calling me sir. But till such time, please call me by my name. And that leadership has to change where you don't why and you don't start missing if somebody doesn't call you sir but addresses you by your name. And finally, the last part, do. Please remember that today's generation is not here to take moral gyan. All of the people, all of the young students who are sitting out there, if I start telling them what to do, what to eat, what to wear, nobody is going to listen to me. So even at IIM Indore, I say one thing to all my students. I'm least concerned about what goes into your mouth. What I'm concerned about is what comes out of it after whatever goes into it. And that is what leadership has to see. You cannot sit in moral judgment. You have to give people the liberty, you have to give people the freedom to actually apply their minds and live the life that they would wish to. The only thing that you need to understand is what are they doing with it, what are they doing with their time, and become a facilitator. So just to sum up, this is the model that I talk about that will lead us to the $5 trillion economy, the Vignaharta way. Analyze the problems that we are facing. I've already pointed out about the five of them. The Pasha represents a synthesis of solutions. Please remember, solutions of the problems do not come from away. Solutions of the problems come from the grassroots level. They are very close to the problem themselves. Sugarcane, the ikshu, is the juice of innovation. Without innovation, we are going nowhere. Trunk is about flexibility and adaptability. We need to be flexible and we need to make sure that we adapt to the digital innovation, to the digital disruption, which is coming its way, whether we like it or not. And finally, Ankush is the push and pull for implementation, which means you have to be a kind of a person who has the grit and the resilience, but you also have to be kind of a leader who is going to go namastak in front of other people and say, give me gyan. Why? Because one of my professors at IIM Ahmedabad, he used to tell this to me. He says, Himanshu, gyan varsha sab jagah se hoti hai. If you're a true leader, gyan varsha sab jagah se hoti hai aur tum sabse seekh sakte ho. Prashna ye hai ki us varsha mein tum surahi leke khade ho ki ghada. Kyunki agar surahi leke khade ho to uska muh itna chhota hoga ki kuch bhi nahi jayega. Aur agar ghada leke bhi khade ho, phir se apne aap se poochho kahin bhara hua ghada to nahi le gaye ho. Kyunki agar ghada pehle se hi bhara hua hai phir bhi usme kuch nahi jayega. So which means go to everyone with an open heart and an open mind, and you will learn from everyone in this universe. Ladies and gentlemen, please remember, the past may have belonged to leaders who did things well, but the future is going to belong to those leaders who not only do things well, but also do the right things. Thank you very much.